the first factor that creates an obstacle before market economy is imperfect knowledge of and between buyers and sellers. This is called asymmetric information. If buyers and sellers have different set of knowledge or level of knowledge or kind of knowledge, and that asymmetry in information creates problems, and this is called imperfect knowledge. This is the first and most important factor that creates a barrier in front of perfect knowledge. The second one is goods are not homogeneous. From last week, as you may remember, we also assumed that in market economy, for modelizing market economy to teach, to learn, we have to deduct real world with models. We have to develop some assumptions to teach you the limits and definition of this framework. And the second one is goods are not homogeneous. Actually, in the real world, for example, ready-wearing companies, textile companies, or milk product companies, all of them are producing very similar, not identical, but very, very similar goods and services. For example, banks or insurance companies. These products, these goods, services are very similar. Some of us may assume that these are totally identical, totally same. But the way of doing business, the services after selling and during customer, producer or seller relationship, services, maintenance of products, these are after selling processes create differences. And these differences actually before selling, after selling, during the maintenance, this creates heterogeneous products. So if goods in the market are not homogeneous, this is also creating some imperfect market structures or market failure. And we can have some examples. For example, advertising, good technical knowledge for the first one, and branding, labeling for the second one are very important to create these imperfect knowledge, imperfect asymmetric information between buyers and sellers. Resource immobility. This is also a very important factor, but in recent technological change, innovation, the perfect mobility of labor force, especially labor force, and perfect mobility of technological improvement across the world, across the sectors, this limits the effect of these factors for market failure. However, still we have resource immobility. Resource can be labor, human resource, can be land, can be capital, physical capital, or financial capital. It can be all components of production process. So this resource immobility factor is also creating barriers in front of perfect market function. Market power is also important. It can be handled in two different ways. The first one is if the market power is concentrated and in one firm or couple of firms, three firms, if market structure necessitates a monopoly, for example, postal services or transportation in railway, or production of salt, or something like petroleum, natural gas that inherently present under the earth, and just states or state monopolies can function these because of the free cost of the resource. In general, we take natural resources like petroleum or natural gas or, you know, seas, lakes, rivers. The ownership of these natural resources belong to state. Can you say what's the reason why we take these natural resources ownership, that these must belong to state? What's the reason? Because the private sector or individuals, they do not do anything to create this treasury. This treasury is, you know, inherently present. So the ownership of this treasury must belong to community, and as representative of community, state is, you know, proxy for using his treasury on behalf of community or society. So market power is important. It will be defined in relation to the structure of market or the size of market. For example, Bosnian market, Turkish market, German market size. Do you think these sizes, differences in these sizes, create some, you know, differences in terms of attracting investors, attracting sellers, buyers? What do you think? The size of, for example, Bosnia, size of Turkey, size of Germany, size of US economies. Do you think these differences in sizes will create effects on attracting foreign, international investors or sellers? Must be, of course, must be. If your market size is very tiny, like Bosnian or RS or, you know, other Balkan countries, market size is pretty, you know, small. And international investors, especially international investors, will not be very eager to invest, you know, to direct their initiative and their, you know, investment to this market, because the size of this market, opportunity of potential of this market is so small, and when comparing other developed and big markets, so the attractiveness of this market will create some market failures. And still, prices are free, quantities are free, supply and demand forces will decide the amount of quantity or amount of level of price, but still there will be market failures because market sizes are not enough big enough that attract foreign or neighboring cities investors. And monopoly or collusion is a crime in many countries. Collusive agreements between sellers. For example, if you have three or four or two more than one, if you have just one seller, it's called monopoly. If you have two, three, or five sellers, like telecom companies, mobile companies, if they had an agreement, hidden agreement, they conceal this agreement from people, and this is called collusive agreement, and it is crime. It is criminal. So collusive agreements between few sellers are forbidden, illegal in almost all countries. Competition rules are against this. So monopoly or collusion will also create market failure. However, economies of scale may push sellers or producers to create, to do some conducive agreements. But these agreements are not in favor of community. So, as representative of society, governments or governance agencies, competition authorities, banking agencies, telecommunication agencies prepare some ethical codes, also some duties, responsibilities for these big sellers, that they are totally totally, they are totally forbidden to make some, to do some abusive agreements. This is totally illegal. And market doesn't supply. If market is not enough to produce goods and services, if the potential of market is insufficient, and this insufficiency, this insufficient amounts will create market failure. And in general, after natural disaster, after, you know, as you remember from May, floods in northern part of Bosnia, Serbia, in many Balkan countries, the natural disaster destroyed potential, you know, infrastructure of the economy, or wars. First World War, the Second World War, or the Balkan Wars during these international wars, or the latest one, also, you know, collapsed 7% of infrastructure of the economy. And these extraordinary situations, these extraordinary problems also distort economic infrastructure, and this creates market failure. And we have also some goods and services that are called merit goods, public goods, or demerit goods, or private goods, that their externality levels are different. Last week or the week before last week, we also discussed this externality that creates some, you know, market imperfections in economies. Now, inequality exists because of in factor of income and endowment. Inequality is not a favorable factor in economies, inequality. In general, World Bank, United Nations, FAO, World Food Organization, World Health Organizations, many international organizations under United Nations, they are fighting against inequality. Inequality between social sectors, ethnicities, different religious background groups, different, you know, income groups, immigrants, locals, all of these create inequality because of factor or income endowment. And these differences in income and factor endowments also create market imperfections and market failure. And wealth distribution, not just income distribution. Income distribution is different from wealth distribution. What is wealth? Last week you also mentioned this. Wealth is accumulated income. You can describe wealth is accumulated income. If individuals or companies or organizations, NGOs, foundation sectors, we have, you know, many sectors in society. They can be individuals, citizens, they can be corporate sector, companies, they can be governmental organizations, they can be, if, of course, it depends on the structure of the country. If the country is just unitarian country, just centrally organized country like Turkey, like, say, for example, Syria, or other, you know, France, to some extent, of course, or if countries are federal structured countries like US, Bosnia, or England, these are federal countries, or RS is also central, but, you know, federation is cantonal level country, and federation is, you know, composing of different entities that are totally independent in their internal domestic affairs. So it also depends on the structure of the country. This wealth distribution, inequality, unequal in wealth distribution is also creating some market imperfections, market failures. And poverty, of course, it's pretty important. Poverty will create some market failures, and we couldn't assume that all individuals or citizens are having same opportunities, same wealth, same income in a country. If individuals are having different levels of power in terms of purchasing power, and they cannot, you know, react same level to price change or economic change in a country. Discrimination, when we say discrimination, we do not mean randomly discrimination. This is planned, organized, maybe legal discrimination. Like apartheid regime in South Africa until recent times. Apartheid regime is, you know, was a racist regime, or, you know, slavery in United States, continental Europe, until 19th century we witnessed slavery across the world, of course, both in Muslim countries, Christian countries, pagan countries, all countries, you know, slavery was existing. So this discrimination, poverty, slavery, these also create some market failures in front of perfect market functioning. External costs and benefits, we mentioned this last week, shortly. External costs and benefits. If production of a company has effects beyond the seller or producer, this is called external cost. If a company owner, factory owner, uses filters for air pollution, and these filters have some cost, of course, and if this producer has to use these filters, the cost of these filters will also affect the cost of and price of production, goods and services. And these external costs create some change in the amount of price, level of price, amount of quantity. And these also, the existence of external costs, existence of externalities create some distortions in market forces, market quantities and levels. When we say private cost, social cost, we mean cost of something may be different between individuals, private ones, or public ones. If private cost and social cost one thing is different, we can say that thing has some externalities. For example, if a factory owner doesn't use filters and produce very cheap products, and these cheap products will be sold from low level prices. What about the cost of air pollution? Who will suffer from this air pollution? Environment, all society, community in that neighborhood. So the private cost of something, if it is different from the social cost, it means there must be a regulatory intervention of government. If I ask you, when public authorities, governments, different types of governments, it can be municipality, it can be province, mayor, governor or mayor, or, you know, branch directors, public authorities, we call all of these as public authorities. When public authorities should intervene the production or consumption processes, you must say that if there is a difference between private and social costs, or if there is a difference between private and social benefits. If there's a big difference between private and social cost, it means the benefit of something is different both for seller and buyer. Benefit and cost are different sides of same coins. They just reflect different dimensions of one thing. So if there are differences in terms of benefit or in terms of costs for social and private sectors, in this case, there's a necessity for government intervention. This is the first and the most important requisite for intervention. And individuals' actions externally is a third part of, or not only the facts of a firm or individual's actions, as we mentioned, already mentioned. Of course, if you are subjected to externalities, then the intervention of government is a requisite. Negative, positive externalities, of course, these are, different sides of same coin. Social costs are private costs and external costs added together. We will give some examples. If the private cost of a good, say, for example, apple or cement is 1 km per kilogram. If the cost of 1 kilogram cement is 1 km per kilogram, and what is the cost of air pollution? How can we avoid pollution? Is there any, very easy way to measure this? We can make
we can question this, so we could go to hospital.
We can ask Ministry of Health that what is the level of expenditure you have to meet because of this air pollution. It's one way. The other way is pollution of environment and the effect of this pollution on other creatures, environment, plants. We can also measure this, of course. But the direct cost is the cost of air pollution on health services. So if the extra cost of air pollution is just 0.5 km per kilogram, the private cost is 1, but social cost is 1 plus 0.5, 1.5 km. The social cost is this. For example, if a factory is producing something that is, very, very valuable for society. Can you give an example? If a company is producing something that is very favorable, very, fruitful for all society. Can you give an example? For example, do you think education is kind of these goods? Education can be, or religious services by mosque, church, Okay, then education. If a company, private sector company, university, or high school, or primary school, secondary school, is creating some services related to education, and these education services benefit all society, not just educated, trained people. The reason is educated and trained people create some positive externalities, the behaviors, the attitudes, the formation, change, supposed to be change, of course. I think after education and training, their behaviors towards society are supposed to be more positive. Do you agree? Yes. Do you have some positive prejudices towards education?
Yes.
Do you think education will also create some negative aspects for humanity? What kind of education do you mean that it is very important? Terror organizations are also educating and training their pupils. Aren't they?
Yes.
So which kind of education do you mean? Do you mean acceptable, legal, universally, internationally standardized education when we see education? So if education, they put that its production, its results create some benefits for all society. For example, the cost of this education, say per student, is 2,000 KM cost. This is individual cost. And the society is also benefiting from this education. Say, for example, 200 KM per graduate. What is the, this is benefit. This is cost. What is the total cost of this for society? Just 1,800. Now, private cost, 2,000. Social cost, less, is less than 2,000. It means, just a second, governments should create some incentives for this production. If social cost is less than private cost, or if social benefit is greater than private benefit, then that product or that process should be motivated by government by trading, by providing some incentives. Yes, gentlemen.
During the education, students go to shop, for example.
Okay. Of course, this is totally different thing. Economic aspects of students. If students, we assume that if students just stay in their neighborhood, you know, their town, they do not move to other countries or other cities. If they stay in their hometown and they go to school in that town, you know, this will not create some extra big things for that town. But you're right, some of you from Turkey are from Turkey, some of you are from Bosnia, and the remaining are from Germany. If you are, you know, coming here from different countries, different cities, of course, the economic aspect of this mobility will also benefit society, but it's totally different. And this can be measured because if you create some economic benefits for the Sarajevian economy, you also take money from other cities, and this creates some negative effects on other cities. So if the benefit of education is greater for society than the benefit to individual supplier, university owner, or high school owners, that means government should motivate this production, this process. And firms and people want to keep costs as low as possible. They won't wish to pay for a negative such as air and noise pollution from factories, car exhaust, of course. If you ask companies, you are polluting the air. Okay, you have to pay this. If this payment is good, I think, and most thinkers think, that nobody will be eager to compensate this air pollution. Then you have to impose taxes, official obligation on this pollution creating people. And visual pollution, you know, some bridges or some, you know, buildings, high buildings, they will, you know, create some disturbances, you know, in cities. So water pollution is also a different dimension of pollution, air pollution, you know, health side effects. These, all of these are, you know, part of the negative effects creation. And when we take all of these together, when we take an overview for this, the maximum price is the billing scale, and it measures how much the buyer values the goods. Last week, as you remember, we mean demand is not desire. Demand is different from desire, different from wishes. Do you remember? Yes. Demand means if a desire, if a wish is supported by purchasing power, then it is called demand. Otherwise, it is just desire. If you have no money to buy something, your desire is not demand. When we say demand or supply, we mean purchasing power. Also, that desire or wish should have. So, willingness to pay, if you are ready, if I put this into auction, public auction, open auction, if I ask you, the opening price for this is 1 KM, this is gold, and this is very, very, you know, innovative pen, whoever uses this, he or she will remember everything he or she reads. This is, you know, very magic thing. During the exams or, you know, other activities, education activities, you will benefit so much. The opening price is and if I collect your books, and do you think each of you may offer different prices for these? Yes.
Yes.
What is the determinant of your offering? Your money level, your richness, your intelligence. What is the reason? Why each of you offers different prices?
Our desire to have that kind.
Your desire, but your desire must be supported by your heart, your money.
Yeah.
Yes. If you just say, I can give 10 KM, it means you are ready to pay 10 KM. It doesn't mean that you are just joking. So the difference in prices offered for this pen is determined by your money, purchasing power. And we use consumer surplus. For example, okay, I offer this one and take all offers from you and take the average. For example, the highest price for this is 100 KM, the lowest one is 2 KM, if it is. So what is the average? Say, for example, I take your numbers and count all offers, then take just unweighted average. What is the average? I can say that 5.5 KM. The average price is 5.5. Now, do you think all of you will buy this from 5.5? No. Some of you offer price that, you know, lower than 5.5. These guys couldn't buy this. But some of you offered higher prices for this, over 5.5. Now, what is the market price? Just, if it is market price, 5.5. It means this 5.5, what happens? 5.5 if market price is this. Say, for example, 20 students offer less than 5.5 and for 50 students over equal source more than 5.5. Now, if this is the issue, these 50 students offer prices over than this, and what is the benefit of these students? Then we call this difference for these students, because they are eager to be more, that amount is surplus. Surplus. It means you are ready to pay more, but market price is low. The difference between your eagerness and the market value is your surplus. It is your benefit. You are ready to pay 10, but the price is 5. What is the surplus level? 5. When we sum all of surpluses, we get market surplus. And it is called surplus. And the remaining 20 students couldn't buy these because their purchasing power is not enough, or their desire is not enough. They can say that, okay, it doesn't deserve this price. I have some alternatives, and the maximum prices that I will offer for this is just 5.5. Okay, now this is called market surplus. Can you fix that one? I think there's a disconnection with electricity.
Why not like electronic?
Okay. Okay, time is over. Tomorrow we will continue.